Now had a far more problematic talent on their books. And they had to find vehicles for her.
Sign your contracts.
Run along, Bob.
All right.
There's one person in the whole world I prayed particularly to meet. It's you.
Thank you. You've been on the stage long?
Not the regular stage, but I was in a lot of plays the Franklin Theatre Guild gave at the Little Theatre.
The Little Theatre?
Yes, at Franklin, Vermont, where I lived until some time ago. The Franklin papers, both of them agreed that I had a future. I play all sorts of parts. Hedda, you know, Ibsen's Hedda, of course. The old woman in Riders to the Sea. The Queen and the Queen's Enemies by Dunsany and Kitty and Shaw's You Never Can Tell.
Bernard also. Shaw?
Yes, the one and only.
Oh, you think Shaw's clever?
He's the greatest living dramatist.
You really think so?
I know it.
Was Hepburn a big stage star when she arrived?
No, she was not. She was a girl who had appeared on the stage in minor roles, or perhaps in a major role in a play that flopped immediately, you know. She was anything but a big star. But she treated herself like a star in the negotiations. She wouldn't sign a term contract, and her agent, Leland Hayward, wouldn't let her sign a term contract, so she signed a contract that gave her X dollars a week for a period of 5 weeks, for maybe five pictures over a period of time. And she was getting what for her at that time was a very big salary, $1,500 a week.
Morning Glory won Katharine Hepburn her first Best Actress Oscar. It was, by the way, a tribute to her own tenacity as well as her talent.
I had a date with Pandro Berman in his office. And like many people, I looked around at the various and sundry papers on the table and read them. And I saw this thing by Zoe Akins called Morning Glory, and I started to read it. And I thought, my gosh, my gosh. And I said to the secretary, cancel the date with Pandro. And I took my friend Laura out. We broke the script in half. And I read it. And then I came back and I said to Pandro, you have a script on your desk and I want to do it. And he said, that script is for Connie Bennett. And I said, over my dead body, it's for Connie Bennett. She was the big star on the lot and sweet to me, always nice. And, but she, I said, does she know anything about it? He said, no. I said, it's got to be mine. Mine, mine. So it was.
Opinions seem to differ as to whether I'll ever be able to make good, Miss Easton.
What do you think, yourself?
Well, I'm just a little bit afraid to think.
She's just a stage-struck kid that I met in Easton's office. I think she's a bit nutty. You know, I completely lost track of you after you left our show.
Well, it's my fault, really. As I was telling Mr. Hedges, I've been frightfully busy. You know how it is. One's continually on the run, seeing this manager and that.
With success?
More or less. You see, I've turned down several parts. I learned my lesson in your show. From now on, I'm accepting no part unless I feel that I'm particularly fitted for it.
I see.
She said and did exactly what she thought, which was... did exactly what she thought, which was unconventional to begin with. So many people were affected and had poses of various sorts, or either from shyness or embarrassment or in sense of insecurity or whatever. But she was seemed pretty secure in herself. And she, instead of dressing up in fancy clothes, would come in blue jeans, one of the first in blue jeans, and bicycle to the studio, or come roaring in some fourth-hand car, hair a mess and freckles all over the place, and so forth. Never bothered to make up or anything until she got ready to work, and then she was wonderful. Well, she was an aspiring actress who took her acting ambitions very, very seriously. I forget what my part was entirely. I just know that it all came off all right, and that where this, what was originally meant to be a three-star show, she won the Oscar, and people have forgotten that Manju and I were even in it.
Here they are, the best of cinema land. 14 lucky girls.